Shabbat Shalom, everyone. Listen, about walking in love. You see, this is an accusation many believers receive, sometimes from other believers, sometimes from the world. Now, let me address this for you, okay? Walking in love, when the Bible talks about walking in love, it talks about walking in agape love, which you mean that is the love of God. It's not talking about the love of the world. You see, the love of God comes from Christ Jesus, because he is the way, the truth, and the life. The love of God is objective. The love of God does not depend upon human nor earthly circumstances, because the Most High himself is unconditional, he is self-existent. So the love of God is God himself, and it only comes from the Lord. Okay? So when you walk in love, you walk in objective goodwill towards other people. Why? Not because they deserve it or not, but because the Lord, the Lord deserves your obedience. Okay? And now listen, walking in the love of God does not mean opening yourself to be exploited and abused by everyone. No. Because we are humans, we are vulnerable. So the Lord has placed conditions for us believers during this lifetime, and you can read about them in the scriptures. You see, one of those conditions are that when someone becomes dangerous for you, you shake the dust off your feet and you move on. Okay? I'm going to give some examples now because I want to illustrate what I'm saying here. Let's say you have a brother or a sister, let me say just a sibling, okay? And this sibling is emotionally addictive, okay? When things happen, they become very emotional, you see? And when you talk to them with facts, they often refute facts, they only give in to what they feel. Now, such an individual, okay, is dangerous. Why is such an individual dangerous? Let me just break this down for you. Emotional injuries are painful and they harm your health, okay? So someone that's emotional all the time, you see, they are open for usage by demons, literally. And even if demons are not involved, people that are very emotional, they tend to make conclusions based on facts that don't exist. Okay? And one thing about those emotional people, they tend to open their mouth, speak out things that really don't make sense. But however, what they are speaking out has an impact. And because they're emotionally addictive, they most of the time don't want to take responsibility for their way of thinking. They will try to blame someone else for it. You understand what I'm saying here? So let's say that you now are going through a difficulty in your life. That individual, when they see that circumstance, they will come with their conclusions, you see? Or maybe demons will whisper things in their ears. And because they're so emotionally addictive, they will give in to what they're feeling. And they will begin to make judgments about you and say things to you that are harmful to you. And get it straight. They will always find a way to blame someone else. It's never their fault. Now, you are a Christian. You are a believer. You're following Christ. Such individuals are dangerous. Possibly even demon attached. Maybe possessed, but they can hide, you know, probably they're demon attached. Okay? Now, are you going to continue to allow this individual to come near you and to spit venom into your life and to spit venom into your circumstances? No, you don't. You speak with them and you make clear unto them that you do not tolerate this. That this is dangerous, this is objectively wrong, and that he or she needs to repent. Okay? You do this. If that doesn't work, you come with more believers and you do the same. If that doesn't work, after a while, and even before the council of the church, it doesn't work, then you consider them like as a heathen, as a pagan. Okay? This coming out of the Bible, okay? You can read it. And also the Apostle Paul told the Church of the Corinthians that He did not forbid them to not have anything to do with unbelievers. Oh, because that is insane. It's out of order. Believers should have contact with unbelievers, or else we couldn't witness unto them. You see, we that are believers became believers, though to contact with other believers that the Lord used. So yes, we should have contact with people that are outside of Christ. Okay, that's obvious. But Apostle Paul made clear that if you have someone that calls themselves a believer, it doesn't matter whether he or she is a real believer or not. When someone labels themselves as a believer, yet they continue in the negativity of the world, you should avoid such an individual, remove them from the community, and you shouldn't even eat with them. You see? And this is something that is also taught in the Old Testament, that you should remove evil from amongst you. Okay? Now, that's something that's from the Bible, okay? And it's also something from the New Testament, okay? And even Jesus said that you should shake the dust off your feet and move on. Now, so when you're walking in love, you're walking in obedience to what Christ has commanded you. Yet, often Christians allow the emotional blackmail of the world to get to them. You see? We may sometimes Christians think, well, if people are hurt by me, then they might become angry at God and they might go to hell. So I need to be more kind towards those people. I need to, you know, look out so that people are comfortable around me. To be carefully. That way of thinking is a lie from the pits of hell. You are responsible to agree with Christ. That's all you're responsible for. And when you agree with Christ, yes, you do treat people in a loving manner, of course, but you're not responsible for people rejecting the gospel. You're not responsible for people rejecting reality. You're not responsible for that. So do not, in the name of love, tolerate dangerous people around you. Do not tolerate messengers of Satan around you. Just so that people may have a good view of you. To hell with them if they do not want to agree with truth. Seriously. I wanted to give more examples, but okay, I'm going to give more examples. Listen. Let's say, for example, you have you have a boss at a job who is very unkind. Now, you're not aware why he's unkind, okay? But you do notice that he goes too far with his employees. Now, you're working there, you're doing your job, you're doing your business, and you leave. So you're not bothering other people. Now, the boss is responsible for his behavior. He knows that he's unkind, he knows that it hurts people, he knows that it's not right, but he keeps on doing it. And he keeps using the blackmail that he can fire you. Now, this is witchcraft, what he's doing here. Now, the other co-workers that tolerate it, they are contributing to the evil by permitting the evil to take place. So they are a contributing factor to the witchcraft that's going on. And let's say you're working there, you're not bothering anyone, but one day the boss begins to target you. And everyone just agrees with the boss because they're all operating in fear. And now because the boss is targeting you, it affects you. It affects your sleep pattern because, you know, you're at the workplace often. So what happens there will affect your life. Your sleep pattern is disturbed. Also, your marriage is suffering because of it. So it's a serious thing, okay? Now, hold on a minute. That boss, you see, that employer is out of order. If he has certain issues in his life, it needs to be taken care of, he needs to acknowledge, okay, I need to take care of these things. The boss should never charge someone else for his own emotional addiction. Because listen, people often get involved with all kinds of emotional things, whether it's sex, drugs, rock and roll, or whether it's sports or not that there's something wrong with those objects, but they get involved just to get emotional relief, so become emotionally addicted. Now, that's their choice of doing that. But they should never charge someone else for them being stuck emotionally. They shouldn't. And now on the workplace, people are just contributing to it, and now you're the one suffering because of it. Now listen, if you're in such a circumstance, you see, if you can get another job, do it. Just leave, okay? If you're a bit stuck there, then decree and speak in faith into the circumstance. Things will calm down a little bit. But still, if you notice that the place is unrepentant, remain in prayer, keep making decrees, and move on. You see? Move on. Okay? And look, let's say you're at the job and you are a believer also. And people begin to charge you. I thought you were a Christian. I thought you were laughing. Don't give in to it. It's an accusation. You see? And you're not obliged to. You should never agree with Satan at all. Never. So that's another example I've given. Now let's say that you left the job, okay? You are now, because people attacked you physically and things really got dirty over there. Let's say you're gone now from the job. Then now you are unemployed. Now you have people coming by, so-called asking how you are, but they hear what's your circumstance and they begin to tell you, well, you should have got better sleep, you should have done this, and it can be they're telling things that it can be they are citing fact, but they do it with the wrong motive. They see that what happened was out of order, but they don't want to acknowledge the reality, so they try to lay the blame at you in a kind manner. You see? Because some people just don't want to, they don't want to accept that they live in a fallen, wicked world where you can be attacked randomly. Many people become frightened at that idea, but it's reality. But many people don't want to accept this. So when something happens to you, just to make themselves feel better, they will try to blame you. Even if it's obvious that it's nothing to do with you, they will still try to blame you. Why? Because they have their emotional addictions and their Jezebel spirits that they don't want to deal with. Now, if someone comes to you and begins to talk to you about your circumstance, but you feel more poisoned and more burdened afterwards, then listen to me. Pray about it. Pray about it. Just keep on praying about it. Also, check those people, and if you notice that they are unrepentant somewhere in their lives, then block them from having contact with you. Throw them out. Because listen, you're away from that job, right? You have faith, you have the Lord. And listen, you block that individual out of your life, and you might see within 2 weeks you have another job, a great workplace, and you even have a better salary than the previous job. So what was happening? You were at a job, things got abusive, you had to leave, and you were in a transition phase to a better place. What happens within that transition phase? You know, demons began to use people to trap you, to prevent you from arriving at the better place, or to cause you to become so damaged that you cannot handle the better place once you get there. And how are demons doing that? They're using emotionally addictive people to come towards you and to accuse you. You see? And the thing is, because there are beliefs lacking spiritual discernment, they don't discern when someone is a messenger of Satan in their lives. And you see, never in Scripture, do you see that the Lord commands his people to tolerate, you know, scorners? Because listen, someone that is unrepentant, someone that persists in a hyper-reality, they are a scorner. Why? Because by them persisting in a hyper-reality, they're automatically attacking reality. And by them attacking reality, they're also targeting any everyone else that speaks reality, that speaks truth. And scorners will cause trouble, they will cause burdens, they will cause affliction wherever they go. So you need to chase them away. You see? And now look at this carefully, guys. Look at this carefully. In the world, I'm talking about the world now. When people don't want to hear something, they flat out tell you, I don't want to hear that. I don't want to hear you. Because listen, in the world, people have their hyper-realities that they want to hold on to. And they don't tolerate people saying things that are contrary to their hyper-reality. So they either become angry or they become hostile towards you when you say something they don't want to hear. Now listen to this. So in the world, when people know they are wrong and you're telling truth or you're telling something they don't want to hear, they attack you just like that. And they always come with some excuse. And listen, when people of the world do it, we accept it. We say, well, okay, he or she didn't like it or they don't like you, so they have a right to treat you bad. With that kind of mentality, no, they don't have a right to treat you bad. They don't. But we still accept it. You see? When worldly people refuse to hear truth. Now, why is it a problem when a Christian, or let me say a believer, decides, I don't want to hear falsehood. I don't want to hear this crap. Why is it that when a Christian has that attitude and blocks people that persist in accusation, why is it then it's a problem? You're not walking in love. Listen, the only people that have a problem with you when you're operating in truth are those that are holding on to a lie. You see? And the reason I'm making this video for you guys is because I sense that there are some of you who need this. Okay? Some of you, you have messengers of evil spirits that are around you, and those spirits are using family members, they're using so-called friends, or people at the workplace, or people at church, just to target you, to burden you. Even if, let me say, often those spirits know that they cannot prevent God's blessing in your life, but they still try to attack you anyway, because they just can't stand the blessing inside of you. And those people that are in agreement with those spirits, they are just as responsible as those spirits for what they're putting you through. Okay? So, don't put up with it. Don't put up with it. Okay? Because listen, when you are emotionally charged, it can even cause physical illness in your body. You see? Because Jesus told us to be different than the world. Jesus commanded us to be free from the world. Why? The book of Revelations in chapter 18, it makes clear. If you are a part of Babylon, that's the world system, you will share in the sins of Babylon. You can share in the sins by either getting involved in those sins or by tolerating those sins. And how do you tolerate sins? By contributing to an atmosphere that is fertile for those sins to grow. You see? And listen, when you, I'm talking to you, believer, when you are tolerating people with Jezebel spirits around you, when you tolerate people that hold on to false doctrines, one of those doctrines is God helps those that help themselves. Well, listen, if you are able to help yourself, you don't need the Most High. So how can the Most High help you if you help yourself? Now, when you're trusting God, you are active based upon the promises of God. So, of course you are active. You're not lazy, okay? But the whole idea, God helps those that help themselves, is not found in Scripture. But there are people that hold on to it. And when you are in a difficult circumstance, they will often throw that phrase at you. You see, when you tolerate such people around you, when you tolerate them to have a space of influence in your life, you are sharing in the sins of Babylon. Because you are receiving them. You see? And by sharing in the sins of Babylon, you will also share in the plagues, which are sickness, disease, poverty, and all of those things. You understand here? So listen, do not put up with them. You see, if people call you unkind, not loving, or a hypocrite, that's their problem. You see, they're not even following God. They're operating in darkness. So why should you even bother what people without God and without truth are singing about you. This being said to all, may the grace of Christ Jesus be with you, and for those that celebrate the Shabbat, Shabbat Shalom.